What I'm going to do today is play some Historic Dimir. This is the deck that a few of my teammates and I brought to the league play weekend last weekend. I think it's really good for Historic, particularly because it is well set up for brainstorm mirror matches, control mirrors, and to play against Is It Phoenix and everything like that. Miso, thank you so much for the sub and your continued support. Now, I have changed three non-land cards in this deck compared to my league weekend deck list. And that's just indicative of shifting from the very like controlled, expected league weekend metagame where I knew I was playing against, the top players with the top decks versus playing on the arena ladder, which can be like the Wild West a little bit. So I basically added a couple of creature control cards, Languish in the main deck, and Enter the God Eternals in the sideboard, and that should set me up to deal better with decks like Mono Black Aggro, Gruul, Selesnya, that those kind of unexpected, or not unexpected, but underexpected, underrepresented fringe creature decks that you definitely do still run into when you play on the ladder. So I'm gonna record this as a video for Channel Fireball YouTube channel. Which means what I'm going to do is commit to five matches on the arena ladder. And before I get to that, I do want to thank my two sponsors. One is Ultimate Guard. I actually used a bunch of the Ultimate Guard super hives to organize my paper collection, kind of like revisited that after not having played paper Magic in quite some time. But, nothing has changed in terms of the Ultimate Guard products being just the absolute highest quality, most reliable, best for protecting and storing and transporting your cards. So I encourage you to check out their online catalog, Ultimate Guard. And then thanks also to Channel Fireball for, of course, sponsoring me and Team CFB and making all this possible. We have two things to mention coming up. These are both related to the release of Adventures in the Forgotten Realms. One is just general pre-orders. We have draft boosters, set boosters, and crates. The crates are particularly cool because they come with full art, Lightning Bolt, Path to Exile, or Sol Ring promos. So yeah, if you do want to get a jump start on your Adventures in the Forgotten Realm collection, Channel Fireball is the place to do it. We also, excitingly, have the pre-release party going on. We're teaming up with Wizards of the Coast to throw the official Forgotten Realms pre-release party. That's going to be July 16th through 18th on Discord. Everyone's invited to participate. So I encourage you to just look into that if it sounds interesting to you, if you have some free time on July 16th, 17th, or 18th. All right, thanks for listening. Let's play some Magic. Historic Dimir. All right, my opponent is starting with the Mulligan to 5. Another Jeskai deck. Well, I guess we'll take a look, right? Yeah, another Jeskai control deck. I'll take Behold the Multiverse since they're already so far down on resources based on the Mulligans. Now, one thing to notice is that my opponent does not have Kahira showing as a companion, so I should expect Torrential Gearhulk, or maybe Brazen Borrower, maybe something else. I'm just going to cycle for one. The important thing here is hitting land drops. Not much luck on the land drops front. Okay. Guess I'll just pass at this point. There we go. That's ideal. I get to make my land drop and shuffle away some of these excess removal spells. I'll keep the Doomblade just in case they do get Torrential Gearhulk onto the battlefield somehow. Now, against the Lightning Helix deck, it's really good if you can get the Sharks up to 4/4 because then they dodge the common removal spells and they're, 4/4 flying is just pretty big, pretty serious threat. All right, how to handle this Teferi? What I'm definitely going to do is brainstorm in response. And then, do I commit or do I dispute? I think I want to commit because it uses my mana more effectively. And then, with some luck, I'll be able to just dispute it a few turns later and continue getting profitable mana exchanges. Shogoff, thank you so much for subscribing. Big shark coming. Yep. Great question from Wishmaster. How can you see the deck list? You can see it either displayed on your screen with the Untapped GG companion, or you can click on the cardboard live icon or the deck list in the commands. I think I'll go with the main phase brainstorm here. Maybe find Narset or something along those lines. Search for Ezcanta, just as good. Shuffling away probably one land and one Doomblade. So I actually didn't see any creatures of any form there. No sharks, no gear hulks, but I am tipped off by the lack of companion. Thinking my opponent maybe does have access to Gear Hulk. Still probably like one Heartless Act, one Fatal Push is good because I think they're extremely likely to have Shark Typhoon. Almost everybody does at this point. Right. Stream Decker is basically, I use Stream Decker when I play Magic Online, and when I use Arena, I use Untapped GG and Cardboard Live. Sorry for that confusion. Think this hand is acceptable on the draw. Sure. Trading Thoughtseize for Dovin's Veto is like, that's fine. That's probably something that's going to happen inevitably anyway. I'm usually going to let a card like Prismari Command resolve because it's actually card disadvantage. Like if they start with three cards in their hand and cast Prismari Command, they're going to end with two cards in their hand. So even if they improve the quality of the cards, I like getting that resource advantage. And yeah, they did discard Torrential Gear Hulk. So again, because I have other stuff to do with my mana and other things to help my prospects of hitting land drops, I'm going to try to wait to get to 4/4 Shark Typhoons, just because they're a little more potent and then they dodge Lightning Helix. I could scry, I could cling. Think just scrying to land drops is good here. And yes, my opponent could flash in Torrential Gearhulk, but they don't have an instant, so it's really not that bad for me if that happens. Those are both really effective cards, but they are not lands. So maybe, how do I want to approach this? Thoughtseize on top or something? Commit my Thoughtseize. Okay, so be it. Okay, I think I can manage that. Now we'll just start moving with the sharks. Oh, this is exactly the reason for discontinuity, sort of counter and uncounterable spell during your own end step. I could also commit it. But no, this is good, I think. Are there a lot of these uncounterable cards in the metagame? Well, yeah, a lot of people in their mirror match configuration after sideboard, they'll have four Shark Typhoons and like two or three commence the end game. So this pattern does come up a lot. Right. I've also used discontinuity to counter or to counter a Nezahal or to stop a Nezahal from coming back into play after it's been blinked. So there's a number of interesting uses for discontinuity. Well, this is the one card I added to my deck for this video, and I bet it's going to be very useful this game and in this matchup. Does discontinuity stop the Yorion trigger for permanents to re-enter? It does, but that would be on your opponent's turn, so you'd have to spend 6 mana. But yeah, that could definitely come up. I guess I'll just Doomblade the Valkyrie and then try to sit on Mystical Dispute for the next couple of creatures, and then Languish will be like a get out of jail free card if things spiral out of control. It's definitely possible. I should have saved the Doomblade for only the righteous Valkyrie, which is the most important creature to kill. All right, I appreciate getting use out of these Mystical Disputes in certainly not the matchup that they're meant for. Okay, I think I want to go... Yeah, Thoughtseize first. Sure. Great question from Kalenda Greco. Why do you prefer discontinuity over Sublime Epiphany? The main reason is that in a blue matchup after sideboarding, if you spend 6 mana on a spell and it gets Mystical Disputed, that's really, really bad. So I'm looking to basically only invest a lot of mana into something if it's uncounterable. So Sublime Epiphany was really good when blue was not a big portion of the metagame and you'd face more like, you know, Gruul and Jund Food and Orzhov Auras. But now I'm less interested in Sublime Epiphany and Torrential Gearhulk because of the numbers of Mystical Dispute, Miscast, Memory Lapse, things like that. But great question. All right, we're going to try for an ambush, see if it works. I guess blocking the Soul Warden is just a lot safer against a possible Collected Company. This is one of those situations where, like, think it's hard to mess up. I could probably hard cast Shark Typhoon to be fine. Making a 4/4 is fine. I don't know. My opponent just decided to pack it up. All right. Kefnet. Heartless Act, Legion's End, Enter the God Eternals, Graft Digger's Cage maybe. Discontinuity, maybe. If this is just a plain Selesnya Angels, I mean, just casting this for 6 mana as like a time walk, that's not that bad. Let's see what I have to cut. Cling to Dust is not super effective because my opponent doesn't have a lot of spells they put in their graveyard, so sometimes it's actually tricky to cycle this. Plus, if I do sideboard out Cling to Dust, I could probably bring in Grafdigger's Cage. So let's have a look at that. Narset is medium. I mean, it's a card draw spell, and it's effective if they have Shaper's Sanctuary. I think Commence the Endgame's not that good because it produces a non-flying blocker. So yeah, I'm actually not hating this configuration. Like I said, Discontinuity might be my next card that I'd be interested in adding. Cut the fourth Narset, the second Search, the third Thoughtseize. One thing about Search and Narset is that my opponent is going to have access to Skyclave Apparition. So it's not great if I play Search for Iskanta and they just play Skyclave. Okay, sure. Go down to one Search. I wonder if my opponent decided they've had enough of Angels versus Control. Thanks for the message, Noble Mason. That's awesome. Good times. Man, all that sideboarding discussion, we don't get to play a sideboarded game. Holy smokes, Hinny Bin, thank you so much for gifting those subs above and beyond the Call of Duty, but I do appreciate it. And if you were gifted a sub, welcome. Happy to have you here. Well, this is a good hand against a creature deck. Notably, my opponent chose Lurrus of the Dream Den. So I guess that's probably most likely to be Auras, second most likely to be maybe a Dreadhorde Arcanist deck. Let's find out. Dreadhorde Arcanist it is. Search for Ezcanta is pretty hard for this deck to beat because it's this deck has a slow clock and its disruption is based on Thoughtseize. So I think if I can survive this initial rush, deal with like the Young Pyro and the Lurrus, then I can ride Search for Ezcanta to victory. Yeah, I think I'm fine with that. Stop the bleeding a little bit. I could have graveyarded the Doom Blade and then like tried to use Languish and Extinction Event to manage the situation, but this way, like I might not have to cast these at all. I can spend my mana on other stuff. Sure. Lots of mystical disputing of non-blue spells so far in this session. Question in the chat, what's a bad matchup for this control deck? I would say Jund Food is probably the trickiest matchup. Trail of Crumbs, Korvald. You're just gonna cast Kroxa. How do I feel about that? I guess it's fine, and I'll discard Languish. Sure. My life total is pretty low, and if I have Ezcanta, I'm not going to need the castle, so I'll send that to the graveyard. And among several good options, I'm just going to pass with Mystical Dispute. So I transfer from the Ezcanta. I feel like it's hard to lose if my opponent can't resolve a spell this turn. Thoughtseize. Transforming anyway. I'll just draw the land. That's fine. And then I can play Narset and still have four mana open. Honestly, I could see just leaving Narset on five. It's really effective against the Faithless Lootings and Village Rites. But I'll use it this one time. One thing to watch out for, given that I'm way ahead in this game, is just not getting sort of punked out by Claim the Firstborn. I guess it's actually pretty bad for me if my opponent just makes Kroxa this turn. Maybe I should have taken a different approach in this game. So again, a little bit of concern for Claim the Firstborn here. Claim on Kroxa. Okay, I think it's time to cash in Narset. think what I need to, this is the card that I really needed in order to like slam the door on the game, cling to dust. So put that on top of my library. And now I think I can't lose. Yeah, Ray House in the chat suggested a good play I could have made a few turns ago. There was one point where I responded to a Kroxa with an Azkanta activation. I could have put Commit Memory in my hand and just discarded it and then had access to memory with Narset. That would have been, I think, stronger than what I wound up doing. Cerulean Drake is weirdly okay in the matchup. Like, it matched up pretty well against Young Pyromancer. Hopefully we don't get to the point where Kroxa is attacking me, but it can block Kroxa. It can also just counter Thoughtseize. So I don't think it's like a amazing card, but it might do enough when you combine all of those things into one. What do I not like in the matchup? So between like Doomblade, Cerulean Drake, and Commence, I'll try one Drake and one Commence. How's that sound? This hand's kind of bad, but I don't really like to mulligan aggressively against a deck that's so likely to Thoughtseize me on turn one anyway. It's like, okay, I'm mulligan looking for a search for Azkanta. They're just going to take it away from me. So Inquisition is actually going to miss here, which is okay. All Are there any matchups where I cut Narset? Yeah, certainly. Like very fast, aggressive creature decks, mono red, Gruul, stuff like that. But this deck, this Rakdos deck's a little bit slower. It's not really an aggro deck. Plus, it does have cards that Narset impacts, like Faithless Looting and Village Rites. And Narset's pretty good against Thought Seizes. Like if they just keep a hand that has like three Thought Seizes but not a lot of creatures, Narset can be really powerful to get onto the battlefield. Kroxa. Okay. So I guess my move here is to respond with Shark Typhoon, then I'll just discard a card and untap and use Baleful Mastery on it. So we're hoping they don't mill Thoughtseize, don't find Thoughtseize. So far they've been a little bit unlucky with their Arcanist hits, but Thoughtseize from the hand here will clean me out. All right, so kill this and mill me. Wow, this just looked like a swamp to me. I didn't even notice this on the battlefield. So you sacrifice it, it deals 3 damage to target player, and they discard a card. Okay. All right, I like that. I like that. Yikes. Oh, they didn't have a sixth card to go for the Kroxa. But this game, I've had a couple of good plays, but this game remains quite close. I feel like I need to draw a graveyard hate card like a Kling or a Grafdigger's Cage to really put myself in decent shape. Okay, so that I can call even if they return a Kroxa. I can try to drown the Lurrus. Sure. And also, should I be fielding this thing? My opponent has gone through four basic lands. I imagine they have, oh, five basic lands. They could be out. Who knows? Not out. So they have access to at least six basic lands. Now we know for game three. That's just Kroxa cast from hand. So, yeah, I think that's okay. And I discard Shark. Corey, thank you so much for the 3 months of support. That's almost the record here on this stream. All right, 7d6. It's pretty brutal. Yeah, nothing I can do. Oof. Did it come in time, or is it one turn too late? Okay, I think I just pass here. Dragonvolt, thank you for the sub. Okay, so I can gust the Kroxa. Still need to find at least an answer to the Lurrus. All right, so I can maybe Legion's End the Kroxa and then try to make a 1-1 shark to block Lurrus. So top. And if my opponent never plays another spell for the rest of the game, I can compete. All right, we'll see. Uh-oh. Okay, so then game three, and I'll try to do a better job drawing graveyard hate cards. I think I'm gonna cut Commence and Cerulean Drake and just have the two Doom Blades. Keep it nice and simple. When do I bring in discontinuity against decks that have access to Shark Typhoon and commence the end game? Ah, didn't get one. Yep. So brainstorm in response. Now I can actually just get the flipped Azcanta going right away, which, as I said in game one, I think is pretty difficult for this Rakdos deck to beat. Also, a major difference is now having access to Cling to Dust in this game. Yep. Yep. All right, I think I'd better get rid of the croaks. Papa, thank you for the 24 months, 2 years. Okay, so I'm pretty sure I'm casting Enter the God Eternals on Luris. And then a big question is, do I want to cash in the Narset? I think I do, but I think I want to cash it in after I cast Enter the God Eternals in case my opponent has Village Rites. All right, so you're gonna get one card, one token. So, question in chat, what's the advantage of playing Dimir compared to Jeskai? We get better mana, which includes access to Field of Ruin, gives you an advantage in like Azkanta kind of mirrors. You also have more cheap cards, including Thoughtseize, which helps you proactively resolve Narset, really, really powerful card in the field right now. You do lose Lightning Helix, which means you lose some ground against aggressive creature decks, but I think Dimir can be better set up against opposing blue decks like Izzet Phoenix and Control and Combo. I guess I need to eat Kroxa. No, I figured. So a lot of times when you have Azkanta going, it's even more effective to just play out your lands than to cycle them. Because more mana gives you more flexibility to use Azkanta. I think I'm totally fine blocking that. Ooh, hello. That does kill my own stuff. So what do I want to do? I have five cards in my graveyard. It's probably pretty hard to lose if I Extinction Event even and then exile the Kroxa. All right, let's see. There's Kroxa, potentially problematic. By the way, my approach here is that I want to pass with Azkanta open because that plays around discard spells. So I can drown to kill this and then drown to counter it. I guess that's acceptable. Maybe now I should main phase Azkanta. Baleful Mastery, that does make my life easier. I think I'm actually just going to use the student cost so I can hold up Drown and Lock in case something goes wrong. Yeah, I've actually exiled all four Kroxas the hard way. Given that they have village rights in their deck, is there any consideration to upkeeping the Baleful Mastery? I did consider it, yes. I still have an extinction event in my deck. I do. That would make things easy. All right. Ill Neville, thank you for subscribing. And Buffalo Box, thank you also. My opponent has 14 cards in their library, by the way. Both of us have about 5 minutes left on the clock. It's been a crazy, Crazy match, crazy game two and game three. Yep. Come on, where's that extinction event? All right, that makes me happy that I've saved the Field of Ruin, although I probably should have it untapped at this point. Also, probably should have upkeeped it. Hang on, let's see. All right, Azcanta first. Thank you. Is there going to be a Channel Fireball deck tech on Dimir? Yeah, I am going to write a deck guide. All right, a hard-fought win. I'm not going to shock myself to Thoughtseize on turn one against an unknown opponent. You don't know how much that life loss might cost you. This a repeat? Grixis, hello. Dragon Volt writes, Search for Iskanta is definitely one of my favorite cards. If that's the case, this could be the deck for you. This is a really good Search for Iskanta deck because you just have so many cheap instants and sorceries. Thoughtseize, Brainstorm, Cling. It's really easy to flip the Iskanta quickly. What's the win condition? Mostly Shark Typhoon, but there's a couple of other things you can do. Interesting. I don't really know what my opponent's deck is all about. I guess I'll discard the Narsa just because she's going to be difficult to protect. I'm also going to set an upkeep stop because I could maybe just transform the Iskanta right away. So yeah, like if I was to cycle this in my upkeep, I could transform the Iskanta. I don't think I need to rush. Is this list currently built for a tournament or for a particular tournament or for the ladder? Well, I originally designed it for a tournament, but I made a few changes to make it better suited for the ladder. So far, it feels pretty good, pretty well-rounded. Is this right? No. We found Iskanta. We searched for Iskanta. We found Iskanta. Yikes. Hmm. Was that just a bluff? Shocking in the watery grave is a bluff? Do I dare? Definitely can't let that Ravager stick around. Thought Seize, so I could just let this get taken and then Azcanta, or I could Brainstorm in response. Pretty close. I guess I'll brainstorm. I get a shark out of the deal too. Okay, so I want to be able to kill Nicol Bolas Ravager and Bone Crusher Giant and Sharks. I guess Heartless Act is pretty effective. Heartless Act, Baleful Mastery, Aether Gust, Drown in the Lock. Probably want even like one Fatal Push. And then what to cut. It's hard to make cuts here. I'll cut the discontinuity and I'll submit 61. It's not particularly responsible, but I actually think submitting 61 is better than cutting something like a Brainstorm or a Kling. Great question from Stamp in the chat. Is there a reason why you don't include memory lapse in this deck? I did try a small number of memory lapses, but I don't think memory lapse is very strong against the top decks right now. Like, it's not very strong against Is It Phoenix? And a lot of the combo and control decks, you'd rather just have a hard counter or a Mystical Dispute. So while memory lapse is really good if you happen to face people that are just like tapping out on their main phase, you know, for like Nissa or Korvald or something, it's really good in those types of matchups. I find that it's just not good enough against the best couple of decks, and specifically the Brainstorm decks. Right, it feels bad to memory lapse a Warlord's Fury or a Faithless Looting or an Opt. Like, a lot of times if they're trying to just chain, you know, if they're trying to get three spells for an Arclight Phoenix return, sometimes memory lapse just helps them. Should I just go for Narset? I guess I should wait at least one turn. Uh-oh. This could be the Dragon God turn. What do you have for me? No Dragon God, just a Ravager. I got the Heartless Act ready to go. All right, sure, I'll discard Mystical Dispute. Will I? If they have another Ravager, the Mystical Dispute's pretty effective. But Shark Typhoon and Commence are so good. But I guess I am going to play Heartless Act and have mana open next turn. So maybe Mystical Dispute's good to keep. Discard Shark? I mean, is that crazy? Kind of crazy, but I'll do it. Am I at all worried about Thought Distortion? I do have Brainstorm if that happens. I think we're good to just take Commence. And then fire off the Heartless Act. Perfect. Unless they have exactly fatal push, this is going to go pretty well for me. The often neglected crawling barons actually comes in handy there. So how much mana do I have? Right now I have seven lands untapped. I get to play my eighth, which means I can field and Thought Distortion. I don't really know what my opponent's holding at this point, but that seems like a good play to make. Sure, I'll go after the blue mana. Why do I crack passage now instead of keeping it for the other brainstorm? It's good to recognize that, and it's often really strong strategic play to leave Fabled Passage uncracked. But I actually was using all my mana that turn, so once you actually need the land, that's when you pull the trigger. All right, one more to go. Top of Vols writes, "Hey Reed, did you guys choose this deck for the league weekend because it fits well against the field you expected? Or is it also a good deck choice if you can't predict what you're going to play against?" It's certainly better if you can predict what you're going to play against, because then you can tailor your like permission spells and removal to be ideal against the matchups you expect. But I think it's just a generally strong deck. Like Brainstorm is the best card in the format, and this is a really good brainstorm deck, so I would recommend it. All right, so I actually get to put my money where my mouth is with a match against Is It Phoenix. I'm gonna take Finale of Promise, just the most powerful card. And I do not yet have Cling to Dust lined up. So these are going to go away, but we'll remember a land, an opt, a Faithless Looting. So I feel like if they have to actually beat me by casting creatures, I'm really well prepared for that. But if they somehow convert this into like a double Phoenix returning from the graveyard draw, I could have some trouble. Clarification, I said that Brainstorm was the best card in the format. I often use best and most powerful slightly differently. Like most powerful is basically like I'm talking about the effect of the card when it's cast. Whereas best also factors in things like mana efficiency and the way it lines up against opposing cards. So when I say Brainstorm is the best card in the format, it's because it costs one mana. It's such a low opportunity cost. It's not because my opponent plays Brainstorm on turn one and I go, "Oh God, Brainstorm again. Now I'm dead." You know, it's just talking about the big picture of the quality and efficiency of the card. Stormwing Entity, I can deal with that. So I can either Brainstorm and shuffle right now, or I could just untap and Languish. Or I could Doomblade. Those are all fine options. I guess I'll just Doomblade. Bottom, bottom. This would be a great turn to find Narset or Kling. Ooh, I got it all. Got everything I wanted. Okay, so Field of Ruin and something are getting shuffled. Then I'm going to play Castle Vantress, grab an island, play Narset. Probably Field and Fatal Push. Then let's be careful to play the fourth land before cracking the passage. I've made that mistake a number of times. And then I'm going to use my all-time favorite move with this deck, which is passing without activating Narset. Just leave it on five. Makes it hard for my opponent to kill with burn and haste creatures, and just the passive ability is super effective. Now I'll use it. I think it's fine to attack or not attack here. Like, you do want to factor in haste creatures out of the Phoenix deck, but I think I'm pretty well prepared for anything that might happen. Sure. Shock the Narset. Narset is shocked. I suppose I will counter that, right? So they don't get the scry. I'm gonna cling the Phoenix so I can either make a 3/3 shark, untap and kill this, or I could just counter it. Yeah, okay, that's fine. You can resolve the Stormwing. So I think my default sideboard against Phoenix is something like this. Aether Gust is not necessary, but it's a nice hedge in case they have Chandra of any variety of Chandra. Aether Gust is pretty effective, and it's never going to be bad because you can always gust a Sprite Dragon or any of their many number of red spells. But depending on the exact cards that I see in the post sideboard games, I could consider Negate, Kefnet, a board sweeper like Extinction Event, bring back the 26th land. But Field of Ruin, like the effect is not very strong in this matchup. They don't have value lands and they have plenty of basics. So kind of just a colorless land, and I don't think I really need it. Oh, Commit also is a card that I could cut, but it's similarly pretty strong if they have Chandra. So I'll just go with this for now. Question about Legion's End in the sideboard. It's the best card you can have against the Auras decks, SRAM and Core Spirit Dancer and all that. So Extinction Event is a good card against Izzet Phoenix. I think it's really effective in game number one. It gets weaker in the sideboard games for two reasons. First of all, I'm bringing in Cerulean Drake. So it's more likely that like Extinction Event will kill one of my own creatures, maybe get two creatures from them kill my own Drake, which is not that great. That's not that impressive. And then the other reason is that they're now going to have stuff like Miscast and Negate. So if I plan my whole strategy around letting them get ahead on the board and then they counter my Extinction Event at the wrong time, I'm going to be out of luck. That's going to be really bad for me. Note that my opponent has mulliganed to five here. My hand is pretty strong as long as I can find lands. All right. Thoughtsies. Huh, so Negate was their worst card. That makes sense. Sure. Okay, I like everything that's going on here. I think I'll plan on casting Narset next turn. So put back like Heartless Act and Narset. Sure. Discard land, Pillar of Flame. Expressive Iteration. You got it. Do the Phoenix decks play with anything that can deal with the Drake? Usually not. Actually, Brazen Borrower. Brazen Borrower would be the main way to get this off the battlefield. I've seen Entrancing Melody sometimes crash through. Dr. Derpinator, thank you for subscribing. Welcome. Just a what I'll call a non-lethal mystical dispute, usually a sign of desperation when someone does that. These are all pretty strong here. I think I'll just take the cage, shutting off Finale of Promise and Arclight Phoenix at this point. I think is going to make it very difficult for my opponent to stage a comeback. Right. Granted, that was a mulligan to five, but I think that was a good showing of what Dimir can do against the Phoenix deck. You just like have all of their angles of attack covered. You got the efficient black removal. You have the Cling to Dusts. You have Narset, whose passive ability is just such a beating against Phoenix. So it's not like you can never lose, but all things equal, you're pretty well prepared. All right, so that was actually an undefeated run. I hope you enjoyed it. I do encourage you to give this Dimir deck a try. And remember, I'm going to be writing a deck guide for Channel Fireball Pro. So if you want to pair this, video slash stream with some written content, look into CFB Pro if you do decide to subscribe to CFB Pro or purchase any Forgotten Realms pre-orders, any other business with Channel Fireball. Please do remember my affiliate code REID, REID. All right, thanks everybody for the stream. On the way out, I'm going to raid Aspiring Spike, and I'll see you again soon. Thanks, everyone.